Hello everybody and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. Disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers can help to clear some things up in regards to questions you might have for the style of discussion video that I do for this series. It is the 25th of March right now, and it is about an hour and a half, a little less than an hour and a half to being midnight, so it'll be probably the 26th, either by the end of this video or during this video. So I'm doing that type of thing I've done in the past where this particular episode, the previous episode in the Thoughts and Opinions series, was on the little Maiden Abyss special, and the video before that was on Maiden Abyss season 2. However, as of recording this one, I actually haven't recorded the Maiden Abyss videos yet. I haven't done the Maiden Abyss season 2 or the Maiden Abyss season 2 special Thoughts and Opinions yet. Mostly because I feel like this one will be a little bit easier to get my thoughts across, and the Maiden Abyss one still, there's a lot that I want to talk about there, and I want to make sure that I'm full and ready to do that video. But I also have multiple thoughts and opinions to get to, so I don't want to keep them backed up for too long if I can help it, but we'll see. So regardless, that's just for context as to why, because even though this episode came after the Maiden Abyss ones, chances are, if you were to sit down and listen to the Maiden Abyss one, I would say, oh, it's the 26th of March, and, you know, then you're going down the list. But I upload them in the way that I finish them, chronologically speaking. So, however, whatever order that the anime was finished in is the order that I attempt to upload them in. Regardless, though. So today, we are talking about The Promised Neverland, Season 2. That's right. The reason why I sat down to watch this was because recently, well, for context, which, by the way, is a word you're probably going to hear multiple times in this video, back in December, the beginning of December 2020, Aki had actually had me watch The Promised Neverland with them. So this was, at the time, it was just after my first job attempt and just before my second job attempt, and so there was a little bit of free open time there. And I remember I think this was also around the time we watched Black Lagoon and stuff, and needless to say, I ended up really enjoying The Promised Neverland. I loved it, had a lot of fun with it. I thought it was a really awesome mystery. I don't remember exactly what I said in my thoughts and opinions video, which obviously, since this is season 2, a link to the video that I did for the first season will be in the description below. But I remember liking it a lot, and it reached a legendary rating for me on my analyst page. And then Season 2, I believe at the time, had already been announced and was going to be releasing only about a month later. It was going to start releasing at the beginning of, I think it was in January 2021. Yeah, it started releasing on the 8th of January 2021. And we both planned to watch it, but obviously I started my new job in late January when the show, I don't think, was finished yet. And then we started not having a lot of time to do things together, and then I think the reception that the second season of The Promised Neverland got didn't strike us fancy, basically, and so we just kind of had it sitting on the back burner for a very long time. Well, recently, another friend of mine and I sat down to watch The Promised Neverland, so it was a rewatch for me, but it was their first time seeing it, and this was only like a week or two ago, not even 2 weeks ago. And so we finished up on that, and I thought to myself, well, this is a perfect opportunity to watch season 2. Regardless of the fan reception, now's the best time. I just watched the first season again. My memory and mind is fresh. I'm ready to go on to the sequel. And so I asked Aki if she wanted to join me, and she agreed, though she was a little bit apprehensive about it because of the reception. And I'll get to that, and that's going to be a big talking point for this. And we sat down and watched it. We started watching it, I think, about a day ago. And then we watched one whole episode because we had finished up on Maiden Abyss Season 2 and then started this show. So we got one episode into it. But we finished up on the rest of the show earlier this morning, and even started and watched like almost half of a next show. So we've been watching a butt ton of anime, so which is great. But As far as us watching The Promised Neverland season 2, we can now cross it off our list. It's been on my planning list since 2020, I'm pretty sure. Now it's crossed off the list, and now I get to talk about it. And I'm going to be very fair here, okay, because I'm sure a lot of people that are watching this have already seen it or are big manga readers. So, and that's the interesting part going into this. So basically what you could see on the surface before jumping into the season is that the fan reception is very, very poor. It's got, I mean, with how highly popular and highly rated the first season was, to go and look at the second season and notice that it has, you know, really mixed ratings. Like it's got a lot of mid-range ratings, a lot of really negative reviews, a lot of negative forum posts on analysts and stuff, and you can just tell like something must not have worked out right. And going into this, it's important to note that I own a good chunk of the Promised Neverland manga, which is not the first time I've ever said that. I tend to own a chunk of every fucking manga that I happen to do an anime video for. I've not read it though, because I don't have the complete manga set yet. I just got volume 6 added to my collection, I don't know, a week or two ago again. So I am a person who is going into this without knowledge of the manga, okay? Because anytime an anime is based on its source, whether that be a manga or a light novel or whatever, and then it either deviates or does something differently, you know, or whatever the case might be, the manga and or book readers, the book readers, I'll just say in general, tend to flip their shit, right? Because, oh my god, they're suddenly changing something that was perfect as it was, you know? And I totally get that. That makes sense. If you're going to adapt something, if you start adapting it based on the source and then change something halfway through, I get that. But if you do adapt something with your own style to it, you know, reimagine it from the get-go, I think that's a completely different story. But it's clear that The Promised Neverland had already started adapting from the source because of season 1 and apparently season 2. Before sitting down to watch this, I was under the impression that season 2, and I also want to make it very clear here that I tried going into this with the biggest open mind that I could. I hadn't read the manga, but I knew that people were not happy about this, right? Some people say that if you haven't read the manga, you will enjoy this. So I will talk, put a pin in that, because that's going to be a talking point here. A lot of other people say just don't even fucking bother, right? But I wanted to have an open mind. It's not fair to anything to hear poor opinions and then go into it with this expectation that it's going to be bad, because then what you will end up doing, as I'm pretty sure I've talked about this in plenty of other thoughts and opinions videos, but what you end up doing is you go into it looking for problems with it. You will not pay attention to what might be good or entertaining or enjoyable or whatever, and instead you will be looking exactly for what is bad about it. You're only going to be looking for that, and thus you'll start nitpicking and you'll start picking everything out, and then once you're done with it, you'll say, oh, that was the worst thing I ever saw, because you were influenced by everyone else's opinion, which is why I tend to not read reviews and stuff before I make my own, because I don't want there to be any like subconscious influence or anything like that. I want it to be my own fresh first-time opinions and thoughts on whatever it is that I'm talking about. And I felt like I did pretty good. I feel like I went in with a pretty good open mind. Of course, I knew what the fan reception was, but I hadn't read the manga, so I wanted to go in with the point of view of somebody that had only seen the anime. How would I react to this if I had only seen the anime? And that's the same as Aki. She hadn't read the books either. She was a little apprehensive to sit down and watch it, which she said herself that usually she doesn't let other people influence her decisions, you know, as to what she's gonna watch or play or whatever, even if it's negative. But I guess this one was a little bit different because it was just, I mean, this isn't like, oh yeah, some people don't like season 2. This is like almost universally, it seems, season 2 is despised in the Promised Neverland fan base. The only thing, I only saw a couple supporters in the comment section of the place that we were watching it, where sometimes you could scroll down and you'll see some people saying like, oh yeah, this is actually a really good show if you aren't a manga reader, you know, or oh, if you're only watching it for the anime, then chances are you will enjoy this. So that's something I think that'll be a bit interesting to talk about. But yeah, so anyways, point is, I loved the first season. I was looking forward to the second season. We finally gotten around to it, and well, we'll see how it goes. So this is The Promised Neverland Season 2 by Studio Cloverworks. And it is a television anime. It's only 11 episodes long, 23 minutes average per episode, and it started releasing in January of 2021 to March of 2021. So from January 8th to March 26th. And it is listed on Analyst as an action, adventure, drama, fantasy, horror show. It loses the mystery aspect that the first season had, which I guess kind of makes sense, but at the same time, the outside world, I still feel like the mystery tag could still be stuck on there, but I don't know, maybe that's just me. So I wrote down quite a few notes that I was trying to keep myself following along with, but in reality, I could probably just recite everything that I want to think of right now without having to look through my notes. But let's talk about my expectations, okay? Because with how much I liked the first season, my expectations were obviously quite high. But especially because in the first season, our characters escape the farm, right? And then they get beyond the wall and that's it. So now the interesting factor comes from the outside world. You know, what are they going to discover out there? And, you know, how's the show or how's the story going to shift from that point? That's what becomes the interesting part. Now, I will be honest in saying that with a lot of stories where characters are trapped or, you know, they're behind something, you know, like Attack on Titan is a good example where they're behind the walls and stuff. A big part of the mystery comes from what's beyond where they can't get, what's beyond that point, you know, or a lot of even just standard mystery shows that set up some sort of mystery that you get really involved and invested in. And then once the mystery is revealed, you know, whether they get beyond that wall or whether the culprit is revealed or whatever the case may be with it, whatever, any story, sometimes all of that excitement and interest you had is lost. Not necessarily because it's not a worthwhile like reveal, but instead just because you enjoyed the mystery and now that it's been revealed, there's no more mystery. So now you're not interested anymore. That can happen. And I guess I was kind of worried that would happen with The Promised Neverland, because that's what I enjoyed a lot with the first season was the mystery aspect and the get beyond the wall. Now I want to see what's beyond the wall, but once I see it, chances are that's it. I'm done with it. In reality, I feel like my interest was actually peaked quite high throughout the whole of season two, because there's a lot of stuff that's introduced, right? And it's not just about figuring out, you know, what's beyond the wall, because now we know it's beyond the wall. Now it turns into kind of like a game of survival for our characters. And that was interesting to watch, though I do have some issues with it, which I'll get to. But I was mentioning earlier, and I cut myself off, and what I was mentioning was that going into this, I was under the impression that the studio, Cloverworks, had deviated from the original source material. What I thought they had done, this is why I thought that it was so poorly received, what I thought they had done was they adapted the first season very well. They had adapted from the source material very well. Then season two, they're like, you know what, fuck that, I'm going to do my own thing. And then they went and made their own story and concluded it in their own way. That's actually not the case. Now, I'm not fully in understanding of this, but from what I've put together, Aki and I had put together, I think what had actually happened is they did adapt the story. They did adapt the source material. They changed the ending, but this was by the author's choice. So it was the original creator's choice to change the ending. Or at least make it fit differently for the anime. I don't know if it still ends the same way the manga does, or if the manga just ends a completely different way. I'm not sure, right? But the problem isn't that they didn't adapt the source material. I guess you could argue that is still the problem. The problem is it's rushed. And what I mean by that is they shoved over 140 chapters, I think, into 11 episodes. And that is the conclusion of the story is included in that. You see, the first season, I think, only adapted the first few books of the series, of which the series has 20 total books in the manga. So the first season, which was 12 episodes long, adapted the first few books of the manga. Then season 2, which is 11 episodes, that's shorter than the first season, adapts like 15 books from the series, including its conclusion. they shoved way too much into 11 episodes and or didn't shove enough into 11 episodes because apparently a lot of stuff was cut. And okay, that happens all the time. Stuff gets cut from the source. Any adaptation, ends up cutting something somewhere, right? You know, but this isn't just cutting out, like, you know, a scene that's unnecessary for the anime. No, this is cutting out big shit. Pretty much anything you need context for in this series is missing, okay? There's a lot of things introduced in season 2 that are just solved immediately or even just brushed over. Like, they'll get introduced and you'll be like, what the hell is all this? And then that's it. It'll never get referred to again because I'm assuming it had its own goddamn book in the series, in the manga, but here in the show, I guess they felt the need to show it but not actually conclude anything with it. And there is a lot of other really weird choices that they make here. The thing is I just don't understand why. Like, is it, I didn't really look up exactly why Cloverworks fucked it up. I don't know if they just were low on money and so they wanted to get it over with. They couldn't, you know, invest in another season of this. I'm not sure, right? I really don't know what the background studio reason was as to why they screwed the show. But as a non-manga reader going into this, it's true that I did find a lot of it interesting. I did find, like, oh, you know, these little reveals were interesting and stuff. But, and I saw a lot of other people say the same thing. But guys, you don't have to read the manga to see how awful the pacing is in this show, to see how awful the story is. They fucked it up. Even if a manga didn't exist and this was an original piece of work, this is shit, the way that they put this together, okay? I think the story is not shit. The story is still great. It's still fine. It's just that you are not going to be invested anymore. Well, you might be. Obviously, our opinions might differ, but I'm speaking in, like, a general term. It's not like the first season where there's a lot of buildup and you're focused on, like, one particular arc of the story. No, this is, hey, by the way, we're concluding the story. Here's 140 chapters worth in 11 episodes. Here we go. Bam, 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 bam. And each bam is some completely different, massively important thing to the story that gets completely shoved off to the side for another thing, to be completely shoved off to the side for another thing. There are characters will disappear and there's no explanation. Characters will show up and then never be seen again and there's no explanation. Characters will just show up and there's no explanation. There will be a character that's shown off and revealed to be this other, you know, to actually be maybe a big bad or an antagonist. And it's like this huge reveal and everything. And then it's like, okay, well, we're done with that in about 2 minutes. And then we move on to the next thing. Apparently, according to the comment section of the place that we were watching it, a large portion of the demon politics and stuff was cut from the show, okay? Now, that might sound boring to you. The problem with that is irregardless of if it is boring, it fucked the show because there are so many things you do not have context for in this season, which makes no fucking sense. That you will see this big demon guy that looks like a king, right? He's actually the duke, I believe, right? You'll see him. He just appears. And it's like, what? Is this guy important? Are we supposed to know who this is? And then he's gone, right? And then he shows up again at the very end. And there's like a queen, a demon queen or something. You know, there's a capital city. The thing is not only do they rush over... What the fuck? I think I just heard dogs killing each other. The thing is they don't only just... rush over a lot of the story elements with it. It's they do it so poorly. There are so many times in this season where it'll just stop and there'll be a montage, a slideshow of screenshots. And I guess this is showing either, you know, some early on, it's okay, it's passable. Like when the characters are first leaving the forest, it shows a montage of them learning how to use bows, right? You know, and arrows and stuff. Okay, this is like a showing their time, the passage of time, you know, they're getting better, they're learning survival techniques. Okay, that's fine, I accept that. I think that's an okay montage to do. Then you'll see another montage, then another one. And then you'll even get to the very last episode where the conclusion is basically told to you in a slideshow. I'm not shitting you. The conclusion is pictures that are shown in like a PowerPoint demonstration of just a few couple little scenes. And it will even show you, I'll talk about the conclusion of the story in a minute, but it'll even show you characters approaching, like it'll show a massive capital city and just a picture of it, then it'll show a picture of like banners and death, like there was a war, and then it'll show you a picture of the characters having taken control of the kingdom. Right? In three pictures, it basically tells you something the story should have shown us, something I would have given a shit about. But no, hey, by the way, there was a war. By the way, this is the conclusion. Okay, now we're done. Let's wrap it up. Let's have a quick, small little piece of animation for the last scene of the show and then let the credits roll, you know? Completely wasted potential. This story could have been amazing if they would have just kept going with it, if they would have taken their time. They could have had at least another season, you know. I mean, sure, it might have still been going by a little bit too quickly, but two seasons would have given you much more time to flesh out these characters, let them get through some of their first initial tasks, and then have the conclusion in the final season, the third season, or whatever, you know, or maybe even put a movie in there. But for whatever reason, I guess Cloverworks has a knack for doing this type of thing. I've seen quite a few shows by Cloverworks and or shows that they have worked on, but I guess this is not new. They have done this for other anime too, where they started off where like, it's like, hey, by the way, we have a great popular show here, a very popular story, and then we're going to fuck it up by rushing it right at the end. I don't know if it's a money thing. It's probably a budget thing. That's probably why it is. A lot of people say like, oh, anime is just a, anime is just a promotional teaser for the manga, which is total bullshit, okay? I think that that's a really lazy excuse to make, because it's true that a lot of people will go to the manga. Like, for example, if you watch an anime and it doesn't adapt the whole story, it might entice people to go to get the manga to finish the story, or in cases like that happened for me with Girls Last Tour, because for whatever reason they adapted all of it except the last two books. I get that, right? I'm not saying that it's not that it's not going to entice you to want to go out and get the manga, but I think it's a really lazy excuse just to say that they make anime just to get you to buy the manga, so they're never going to finish it. That doesn't even make sense in this case, because they concluded the story. And if this fucked it up too badly for anime viewers, they might not even want to read the manga. I guess you could say that the psychology behind this is that it'll make you say, oh, well, the manga has to be better than this. Let me go read that, you know. But whatever. I don't know. I just don't agree with that point of view. I'm not saying it's not true. I'm just saying that I think it's a really lazy excuse to make when saying, you know, this is why something was rushed, or this is why something wasn't finished correctly, because it's just a teaser for the manga. You know, they actually release previews and teasers for the manga. It's its own separate thing. It's even its own category on analyst, on database websites. So that's an actual trailer for the manga. This is an anime. Okay, if they fuck it up, they fucked it up. Not just because they want you to go buy the manga. Okay, so I talked about the pacing and how they handle the story. They screwed it up. As a non-manga reader here right now, until I get around to reading it someday, I can tell you that this is not paced very well. It's not structured very well at all. It's not, it's concluded very abruptly, so many things are, like I said before, so many things are introduced and then just never even talked about. It's just like they're dropped. Like, this would have been something that, you know, our characters would have sat down and talked about in the manga. Well, no, not here. There are some other elements that I think don't have anything to do with the anime, but instead were just the original story that I'm not that big a fan of either, but that's just a personal take that I guess I can go over here at some point. But some of the other stuff was a bit questionable too. I think the visuals are fine, but I do have a little bit of an issue with the CGI wild demon that chases the characters multiple times. Mainly because it looks so subpar. This is 2021. Yeah, this is 2021 we're talking about here, and it looks like it has CG from the late 2000s It's very rough looking, and the only reason they hide it so well is because it's a black demon. The CGI model itself is black, and it's always shown basically at night or right around the time that it's getting dark or is coming into light. It's got one of those models. It almost reminds me of, it's nowhere near as bad, but it almost reminds me from what is that one series called that I just could not stand? Let me, I guess I have to go look. From Commonplace to World's Strongest, okay, which to this day has some of the worst looking CGI I've ever seen. It almost reminded me of that. It's nowhere near as bad though, mind you. But the problem isn't just that it looked a little off. It looked like they were reusing a lot of animation. There's like this scene where they're running around a giant CG tree, and you see that multiple times. You'll see them with getting chased by the demon, and it's the same demon animation each time they show it. It's subtle because you only see it a few times, and it's really short each time. But it just, and I'm sure plenty of shows reuse animation like all the time. You know, it saves on money. You know, that's just a normal thing to do. But for whatever reason, it was more noticeable here because it's right in your face when they do these things, right? And the show is so short that they're reusing this stuff in such a short runtime. I mean, this is only 11 episodes. It's not even as long as the first season. It's shorter than the first season, and this is what I would consider a short anime season. You know, the 12 episodes or 13 episodes length. That was something that I had picked up on that didn't strike me too fancy. There are tons of time jumps. Obviously, when you're rushing a story like this, every other episode feels like a fucking year has passed. There's also some confusion with the time jump. This could have just been my problem here, and I just wasn't understanding it. But I very vividly remember them looking in their journal, and it said January 2047. Then the next episode starts, and it has now been like a year, and their journal says January 2047. So either they showed us the other scene too early, or it had already been a, but, and the reason is that you can tell it has jumped ahead so far is because between those two episodes, even though the journal says the same fucking date in it, it has been, the characters have upgraded, they have grown up, the characters are more mature looking and stuff, so time has passed between those two episodes, yet it still says January 2047, okay? You know, because the show starts, we go through the year like 2046 and stuff, like we talk about in The Promised Neverland. I don't know if it starts in 2045 and then ends in 2046. So when our characters get outside of the walls, it's 2046, and then we jump forward to 2047. You know, weeks pass by, months pass by in between episodes. They do try to show you the passage of time with the little montage, like the little training montage and stuff, which is helpful at least to showcase that. But you know how I am with time jumps, right? It can be done so poorly a lot of the time, and it's just, What probably bothered me the most, though, with this season was introducing all of this really cool shit and then not going anywhere with it, or wrapping it up in, like, two episodes. That was the stuff that I probably didn't like the most, right? I could have accepted it concluding so abruptly like it does, if they actually, you know, picked something from the story and decided to focus on it. You know, there is another farm, the Lambda farm, that is basically a research facility, okay? And it's introduced and then showcased how it was defeated and destroyed. There's a new antagonist introduced, and then this antagonist is basically shown maybe four or five different times on screen, gets maybe about three sentences worth of dialogue to speak, and is then just defeated. And you're supposed to give a shit. And all this happens in the span of like a couple episodes. And you're supposed to give a shit about any of this. Meanwhile, the Gracefield house where our characters started the series gets its own full season of our characters growing, our characters training, and our characters getting out. But no, here you will take a huge piece of the story. Like, I feel like this whole Lambda research facility is extremely important to the story, and it just gets completely obliterated by this pacing that this show has. And that's just one thing. There's demons outside the wall, right? They introduce the story about, you know, where, you know, about the demons and humans and stuff like that, which I think this is interesting. So obviously the whole idea in the original was, you know, what's beyond the wall? Well, there are humans out there, right? We know that there's humans out there. But, I mean, at least that's what they said, that we've been told that humans are out there. But there's also these big creatures known as demons that are walking around in the, you know, just outside the farm. So what's going on there? What's all that? Well, we do get to learn about that, basically through exposition and dialogue. And it's that, essentially, something along the lines of, 1,000 years ago, there was a war between demons and humans. I don't remember if the character specifically states why or where demons came from. I don't think it matters. And they say that there was this promise made. There was this deal, basically, that was struck, where essentially, like, demons, like, humans were hunting demons to extinction, I guess, was what was happening. And so they decided that they would split their worlds in two, where one half of the world is for humans and one half of the world is for demons. The rules are none can cross between the gate. So no demons can come to the human world and no humans can go to the demon world. But the catch is that you learn later on in the show is that demons maintain their humanoid form by consuming humans. If they don't consume humans, they end up morphing into what they call wild demons. They basically become feral, and they'll eat their families, and they'll start tearing, so they become animals, right? Essentially is what happens. So they farm human children. They have humans that they farm and breed so that they can feast upon them. But what's lost in translation here is, it feels like there's more to this. Like, for example, they talk about at the very end, they briefly talk about how, like, the higher ups, the royalty is controlling and manipulating the common people with this tactic, and that humans aren't actually necessary for the survival of the demons. It's just being, like, used as a control tactic. But like I said, it's just brushed over. You don't actually get to see any of that or see it concluded or anything. You know, you don't get to learn about the politics of this kingdom. You just get to see, like, this capital city, a picture of it, and then apparently it's fallen and it's been taken over by the good guys. I don't know, whatever, right? It's sad, because all of this stuff would have been really interesting to see in the long run. But fuck you, you don't get to see it, not in the show at least, which really, really sucks, because I thought all of that was interesting as it was introduced. In the first season, you have the character Minerva, I believe, William Minerva, who had left behind these messages in books, and it was messages of the outside world to give children hope. Well, we do follow Minerva's story using the pen that Sister Crone had left behind, to basically try to catch up and find Minerva so that they can be saved, right? That's kind of what the plot of the story is, at least starting off. Unfortunately for our characters, it turns out that Minerva is no longer around, but his real name is, what was his real name? I think it's James Rattray or something like that, right? And later we are introduced to a character named Peter Rattray, which is his brother, who is, like, the head of the research facility, the Lambda research facility. And he is, like, this big, nasty antagonist. Like, the moment they show him, they start drawing him with these really evil facial expressions. Like, they're trying way too hard, and then he's just gone in, you know, a couple episodes after that. You know, he doesn't get time to be an antagonist. He doesn't get any buildup. I don't give a shit about this guy as a bad guy. I don't give a shit about his tragic background. Fuck him, right? You don't get enough time to give a single flying fucking shit about this guy or his family line or the research facility. They don't care about that. Similarly, a character from the first season that had disappeared returns in this season, and they totally try to go for the Aaron Yeager route. They try to make him like, I will destroy the world to save it, you know? This is my destiny. I have chosen this. Except that's what he says, like, one episode after he's reintroduced, and then you're just supposed to give a shit about it. You see, the difference here is, guys, is as far as the anime is concerned, not the manga, because I know that there's 30 volumes in the Attack on Titan manga. Attack on Titan, as far as the anime, it gave Aaron Yeager like 7 seasons to build up to that point, that breaking point. You know, here they give you about 20 minutes to build up to that, and I'm supposed to follow with this character or feel for this character, you know, or try to understand this character. No, it might not be forced in the manga, because they might actually give a shit about pacing in the manga. I'm not sure, I haven't read it, but here in the show it feels so forced. It just feels like they are forcing this character to be this, you know, this like anti-hero. And I just don't get care about him. I just don't care about any of it because they don't give you enough time at all to really get to sit down and care. The only characters I actually started to find interest in were the demons known as Mujika and Sanju. These two characters are the first proper people that our characters meet after escaping Grace Fieldhouse. They are demons. And this I thought was great. I thought that when they are saved, because they're being chased by a wild demon, and they end up getting saved by two people, and at first you're like, oh, this must be Minerva, or this must be some resistance group or something hiding out in the forest, you know, to save the children. Then it's revealed, no, they're actually demons. But they're not consuming the children. Why? Well, there's a whole bunch of different story beats. Like, for example, later on when the kids set off into the desert, Sanju reveals that he actually wouldn't mind eating humans, but he doesn't want to eat farmed humans. He wants to eat organic humans like he would eat, like, an organic animal. So he wants to wait for them to go off into the world, breed, and then, you know, spew out offspring so that he can hunt them and kill them, right? But he doesn't say it like he's evil, and I'll talk about the morally gray area in just a moment. But then you have Mujika, who ends up later being revealed to be... She's very adorable, she's very cute, she's very very nice, very soft-spoken. She's later revealed to be what they call an evil-blooded demon, or what I keep calling Elder Blood, for whatever reason. But essentially, she has this lineage that's apparently really important to the story. Fuck off if they actually want to, you know, take time to explain that. But her blood has the ability to stop the degeneration of demons. Before, I talked about how demons are required to eat humans in order to not degenerate into a wild animal, basically. And they will mutate and, like, start growing extra arms and growing extra eyeballs and stuff, and it's really gross. But if you are to drink the evil blood, as they refer to it, you end up... it cures your degeneration, so you will no longer degenerate, and you will also, I guess, live for very long periods of time, and you can even regenerate limbs and stuff. It seems a bit overpowered. But this becomes important later on when the character that returned is trying to wipe all of the demon kind out, and then that just kind of gets wrapped up right away, and then, hey, let's start feeding everyone demon blood, you know? So that's her importance to the story. I enjoyed these two characters. I enjoyed the reveal that they were demons. They do eat meat. See, I thought they were like maybe vegetarians. They do eat meat. They just don't eat humans because I guess it just doesn't feel right. Because of their religion, it doesn't feel right to eat these farmed people, basically. I don't know, really. But here's the thing, okay? A character makes an appearance, a return, that being Norman, the third character, the third main character from the original series. Obviously, you've got Emma, Ray, and Norman from the first season. And Norman gets shipped off, but it's kind of ambiguous what happens to him, because even though he's being sent to be shipped off, he opens a door to meet somebody, and then that's where the clip ends, I think, in the original season. So you never see him die. And as is tradition in this type of story, if you don't see them die on screen, they are still around. Well, Norman reappears in this show as someone hiding out in the demon world, just like Emma and her group. And it turns out what had actually happened, to go over it, you know, as briefly as the show does, he had been shipped off to another facility, another farm known as the Lambda facility, or Lambda, I almost said complex, that would have been very bad, Lambda research place, plant. And he had, the person he had met was Peter Dinklage, or sorry, yeah, Peter Rattray, or whatever his name is, right? The brother to William Minerva. And he had become a test subject, basically, because the Lambda research plant is all about these vigorous tests and experiments on people and stuff, and on humans and stuff. And it's run by a human as well. So, who's in, like, some sort of cahoots with the royalty, with the demon royalty. And you get to see a little bit of this facility, and then, of course, you get in basically a few different scenes, a couple scenes that go one after another, you get to see that Norman was fed up with it, and he used his smarts to break out of the facility, and he saves a few people on his way out, and those people become his new group of basically test subjects that all have ridiculously crazy-looking designs to them. And thus concludes his story and the whole Lambda story and the whole, you know, Peter does come back at the very end of the show, but it just all happens so quickly, you know. But yeah, so Norman's whole thing is that he's out for vengeance. He wants to wipe out all of demonkind for what they do to humans. Now, I don't blame him or his other friends that he had saved from the facility. I don't blame them for wanting to strike vengeance against the people that have been consuming them for 1,000 years, right? I don't blame them for that. What I do have an issue with, though, is... Well, I guess it's not an issue, but this is where you get a morally gray area introduced. Because at this point, you've seen a demon village in the desert. You've seen, you know, demon kids. Thing is that the demons are people. You know, there's no way to deny that. They are just people like us. They have families. They have emotions and feelings. They have wants and wills. They are people, right? And the problem with it is that from what the story won't really tell you is I'm pretty sure the common people have been manipulated into this whole human consumption thing by royalty in the capital that you don't actually get to see any of. And so they have this misunderstanding about how they need humans to survive. And to them, it's normal. Eating humans is normal, right? The brains, you know, high-end, high-grade brains is a delicacy. But eating, you know, you'll see at the shop there'll be human hands just in, like, a big tub that people can buy or whatever that demons can buy. It's normal for them, right? And obviously it brings in the very heated discussion, the topic point of, you know, well, we eat pigs and cows and stuff, and is it really any different? Because we just keep them on farms and then slaughter them and then eat them, you know, and it's like they can't really do anything about it. You know, I'm not going to get into that whole debate. But it does kind of make you think about that type of thing here. In fact, the opening, which I'll talk about, is really cool because I like the symbolism in the opening where you will see the kids sitting around a table with a rabbit on their plate, and then it shifts into a child on the plate, and then it's demons sitting around the table. I thought that that was really cool imagery because on the surface, it's not all that much different, but then you might, this is where it gets heated because someone can argue that, well, rabbits don't have a will. They aren't sentient like we are. They can't be reasoned with, right? Like humans can. Demons and humans, though, are a lot more similar to one another. But that's a discussion for another time. Either way, it's a morally gray area that comes up in the show that I thought was pretty interesting. Because Emma, being the character she wants to, I have to be honest and say that Emma's just, she's getting kind of boring to me. She was pretty cool in the first season where she wanted to save everyone, but then she kind of had to leave the young ones behind. She had to come to that realization and accept that, and so she could save everyone that she could save. Well, all she wants to do at every moment she's on screen is save everyone. I don't want demons to die. I want to save all the demons. I want to save all the farm kids. I want to save, you know, everything she says is I want to do the impossible every single time. Now, I get it. She's a good character. She's very good-hearted. She wants what's best for everyone, including demonkind. I get that. The problem is you can't just make the hero character, in my opinion, you can't just make the hero character constantly want the same thing, because then the impact of them wanting to save everyone is lost over time, because she only wants the same thing each time, and it's always the most extreme thing that she wants. She always wants to save everyone, so I start losing interest in wanting to save everyone. You know, I don't know if that makes much sense, but it just seems like she's very one-dimensional at this point. She's not like she was in the first season. She's a lot more cookie cutter here in season two. Ray gets a lot less time to be smart and whatever, but he does get to show his smarts a few different times. And Norman is just nowhere near the same character he was, but I think that's intentional because he was stuck in a facility and being fucked, basically. Right, so I think his change of character and pace is totally understandable. I get that, right? Even if I'm not a fan of the direction he goes in, and wanting to wipe all of demonkind out, mainly because it just seems so, I don't know, it just seems like, does he really think that that's the viable option? Like, does he not see that that just doesn't make much sense in the long run? It's not, you know, it's, I don't know, it's, it just feels like it's, whatever. I can't tell if I really like that story beat there, if I really like the whole wiping all of demonkind out. Well, either way, he wants to wipe all of demons out. He's developed this drug that can make them degenerate instantly. And apparently this one drug he's going to release, you know, overnight is going to wipe all of demonkind out on this entire planet. Now, they don't exactly explain how the two worlds are separated, but it looks like it's some sort of dimensional gate that they travel through, where it's one entire planet that is the demon planet, and then once you travel through this gate, you are in the human planet. So I don't know if it's the same planet, it's just two-dimensional, like, you know, parallel dimensions that are stuck on top of each other or something like that, where you can shift between the two if you travel through the gate. I'm not 100% sure. But regardless, though, the world that they are in here is interesting, at the very least, the demon world, because it's very much like the human world, but it's demon kind. So, you know, architecture is different, politics are similar, but are obviously going to be different. They're farming human children and stuff. But things get even more weird and interesting because there are moments where, like, for example, Grandma, which you might remember from the original, she's like the head of everything, right? She's at the HQ, and she's this really mysterious character. Well, she just disappears. And then suddenly Isabella comes back as the grandmother. She's now Grandma Isabella. And it's like, okay. I mean, they don't exactly tell you how that doesn't happen. Like, they do kind of allude to what happens. Like, it looks like, you know, the children have escaped. Isabella is in prison, I guess, because she had fucked up so much and let her children escape. And then the grandmother says, I'll handle it. You know, I'll find those children. And then you see her, the grandmother's attack group, attack the children. And then they get defeated. And then suddenly Isabella is given an opportunity to try and get the children back. But this is before you see the attack group get defeated, if I remember correctly. And then suddenly the grandmother's just missing. And now it's Grandma Isabella. And I don't know if what was supposed to be alluded to there was that the grandmother failed, so Isabella took her place as an opportunity given by the demons to make up for what she fucked up on. And I almost wanted to refer to this as, and I even said this when Aki and I were watching, I said, this is a backstab simulator. Fucking constantly, like, at the very end of the show, it's like one backstab after another. One character will be like, haha, I've got you where I want you, you know, right in my sights. But aha, actually, I'm going to aim my gun at this person. And then aha, we're actually being surrounded by another group of reinforcements. But then aha, they've been surrounded by friendlies, you know. It was kind of a bit comical how it was one backstab after another each and every time, where it just felt like, I don't know, I really like it, right? I really like when a bad character, like an evil character, turns to the good, and I really like when a good-hearted character turns to the evil side, and they turn, switch sides, you know, and then they, you know, they aim their gun, or you know, they take up arms against whoever might be their brother, or, you know, something like that. I really like that kind of storytelling. Again, the problem is, you need time to give a shit about it, so that you, there's this emotional weight behind their decision to change sides. But here, that doesn't happen. You get to see like 10 different fucking people backstab one another right after one another, you know? And you don't, like, Isabella, she comes back. She was one of my favorite characters from the original season. And she gets a couple scenes in this entire season. And she mostly only shows up right at the end to surround the kids and say, haha, you failed, you little shits. But actually, I'm on your side, you know? And then she starts turning her gun towards Peter Dinklage, who's this fucking guy that, you know, is the main antagonist of the show, I guess, this time around, right? And it's like, I don't feel any emotional weight from Isabella doing this, because we just don't get enough time to see her go through the steps. We didn't even get to see her become Grandma Isabella. She's just Grandma Isabella already, you know? Sucks. There's some other stuff. One of the other things that I had a big problem with in regards to the Promised Neverland Season 2 is the incessant coincidences, okay? Now, let me be straight. Let me be frank here. I get it. Stories exist because of coincidence. That's how a story happens. That's how story writing occurs. A story can only happen if a coincidence has occurred, or if coincidences do occur, right? Not arguing that at all. I'm not saying a coincidence can't happen just because it's a story, a fictional story. Absolutely not. They happen in real life, they can happen in stories. The thing when it gets distracting is when it is nonstop coincidence. When every single thing that moves the plot forward is a coincidence, it starts to lose steam for me. It starts to become less interesting. Kind of like how I was talking about earlier, what with the character Emma, where I start to lose, you know, I'm not as invested in Emma's character because she only ever wants the one thing, and thus she's not making sacrifices, and so she's not as interesting as a character to me. It's kind of like that with coincidences. If you keep showing a coincidence every time the characters are in a bind, or every time the characters need information, oh, by the way, here's the information you need. You know, I wrote down a few in my notes here. Where did I write it down here? I said, so, lots of coincidences, right? You have the 1,000 years ago. It's been 1,000 years since the demons and humans had parted, okay? Yet, there are the Minerva books in the farmhouses and stuff. Okay, so this is just a minor coincidence, but how would those books even be relevant anymore if it's been 1,000 years? Were the books around for the past 20 years, 30 years, whatever? Well, you'll learn later that apparently it was 15 years ago that a piece of shit was left behind by Minerva, or one of Minerva's men, maybe. And it's been 15 years since that thing was retrieved, and now the kids have a hold of it. It's been 15 years, and yet this little fucking thing has information on blueprints on the entire headquarters and stuff. You know, it has everything they need. And what makes no sense to me is Norman is dying. He has, from all of the drugs that he has taken in from the Lambda plant, he is dying. And so he wanted to look for a cure, but he couldn't get one because the research facility had been completely wiped out, wiped clean, and a lot of the data was lost. Well, thankfully, this little chip from for the pen from 15 years ago that has the blueprints of the HQ just randomly has a paragraph on the cure to the drug. What the fuck? That makes no sense to me. I mean, I guess it has to make sense because it's there in the story, but this is way too coincidental. Why does this blueprint page just have information on the drug cure, specifically exactly what Norman needs? It's way too convenient. But that's not where it ends. There's lots of timing. Every time something happens, like they get a radio and they want to listen in on broadcast, so they take the radio out and oh, suddenly they hear the radio broadcast the moment they bring the radio out. The necklace is another thing. The necklace gets dropped at one point, a necklace that was given to Emma by Mujika. And the necklace gets dropped, and it's just in the nick of time to be spotted so that our characters are saved. You know, okay, that kind of thing happens all the time, or characters get saved at the last second. I get that. That one's so normal that I basically expect it at this point. But all of the story is told in these various different coincidences. Like, I'm pretty sure I wrote another one down. But there is a lack of variety in the monsters, the wild demons. Apparently, you will turn into these big beasts that chase our characters around. The problem is that even though they say there are different types of beasts out in the forest, and they even find footprints of different sizes, the only one you will ever see is the big giant one that's got like six legs. That's the one you'll see. You won't see any smaller versions. You won't see any bigger, you know, bigger ones or different ones or anything like that. It's just that same one that they keep reusing throughout the whole show. And it shows up like four times throughout the show, if not more. Some other things that are more nitpicky, I'll say, are, for example, when our characters actually go out into the desert and they find an old facility that was apparently left behind by Minerva, and it's like the safe house. It's kind of like, it's got all their rooms and it's got a little farm that they can grow stuff at. Nobody's there anymore, but a message was left behind on a payphone from Minerva, basically, you know. They have this pen that they're able to enter. They have to figure out clues. They enter a password into it, and then they get a location, coordinates to go somewhere so that they can, you know, find the next piece of the puzzle, basically. You know, that stuff is interesting. I thought that was really cool, but that's not what the show focuses on after a while. Anyways, when they're down in this facility, there's lots of questions to ask. Our characters, some of the characters, side characters, find a room that has all these etchings in it that say, help. And it's like, there's kids' names in here. You know, and there's like a little booklet and stuff, and you ask all these questions of, is this place a prison? Did this place used to be a facility that tested on kids? Have other kids escaped farms in the past, you know, like long before Emma had escaped, you know, and this was where they were led to, which then adds to the question of, how long have these books been around, which adds to the coincidences I talked about earlier and about the thing from 15 years ago. If Minerva hasn't been around all that long, he can't have been around all that long because of his brother Peter, And you even get to see Minerva's death. You get to see William's death, or whatever his name was, James Rattray or whatever. You get to see his actual death. He couldn't have been around for 1,000 years. He couldn't have been around for hundreds of years. He has to have been around in recent times. So how could all of this been set up? And how could there be all these kids that were in this facility before? But, okay, at least they'll answer it, right? No. No, they will not. There will be this room with all this help etched on the wall, and they will never address it. The characters will never bring it up as a piece of importance. The characters will never talk about it. Nothing. Fuck it. You don't get to know any of that, what any of that means. Well, Granma's fighting group comes charging into the facility. They somehow knew where the facility was all this time. This was pretty cool. You get these, like, soldiers come walking down into the facility. They're holding MP5s. Now, nitpicky moment. Why are they holding MP5s? If the world was split up 1,000 years ago, why are there MP5s? And if we're now in the future, in 2047, why are we using, like, an 80-year-old gun? You know, it's... Okay, I'm just saying... I'm not saying that they have to be using modern technology, but you could make the argument that, oh, maybe time stopped advancing, right? You know, in the demon world, and so technology hit a threshold. Well, the MP5 is a human creation, and the worlds would have been split up before the MP5's creation had even come to be, so how did they even come up with that design philosophy, and then why would they then not make anything more advanced than that? I don't know. It just feels like they didn't want to make anything new or unique, which, I don't know, whatever. That just, it's a total nitpicky thing. I totally understand that. But it just seems so weird to me that if the worlds are apart from one another, there should be no reason that we're using a human gun from an era that didn't exist in the demon world. It should be a unique weapon, maybe a unique type of gun or firearm. I mean, it can be whatever the hell you want it to be. There's also, like, these really old, almost 1940s looking trucks. Yet then in one scene, you will see a totally like a 2015 Subaru. Like, you will see this really fancy, very modern looking car, and okay, well, what then what's the whole 1940s looking truck? Why is their technology look old but new? You know, why do their computers and stuff look like ancient pieces of tech? You know, why are they using these old school radios, but there is a payphone in there, you know, etc. There's like this weird disconnect between the technology that exists and doesn't exist. I mean, if like they were going to the human world and getting technology and bringing it back, like if they were making trades, okay, that would make sense, because then they're bringing technology and then maybe reverse engineering it or something. But no, that's never established. It's been very clearly stated that it is not allowed for demons and or humans to cross over into each other's worlds. That's like the rule. They don't do that. Not saying that can't have happened, but whatever. There's a whole bunch of other stuff too. There's like this old granddad demon that's got this daughter named Emma, and that's pretty cool. The scene where Norman attempts to destroy the city, the desert village, and lots of people are getting killed off, lots of demons are getting killed off, and then that's when I liked where Norman was attempting to kill this little girl, and then the granddad stops him from doing that by getting stabbed in the hand, and then this little girl's transforming and stuff and degenerating, and that's where it's revealed that the grandfather has the evil blood in him, as he's able to feed the blood to the daughter, and so her degeneration goes away, he regrows his arm, his hand, or whatever. It was a really cool scene. I liked that. It was probably one of my favorite scenes in the show. And then Emma and Ray and stuff confront Norman and basically tell him that he's an asshole and that he needs to stop being scared and trying to burden all of this shit on his shoulders and you know, whatever. That was probably my favorite scene as far as drama was concerned. It was nice to see him stagger and realize, you know, what I'm doing might be kind of fucked up. Maybe these are people, you know? There's other characters like that kind of pop up here and there, but you have, you know, like where it's like, oh, is Norman actually a bad guy? Is he working for Isabella? And then, oh no, he's not. He's a friendly, but oh, maybe one of his group is working with the bad guy because he's talking to them in secret. But oh no, it was actually a secret piece of sabotage where they were pretending to be working with the bad guy to get information so that then they could backstab them again. And when they actually go and take on the farms to save all of the children, it's really stupid because this should be a really important piece of the story, but no, it's done in like an episode. They attack with hot air balloons. The hot air balloons are getting shot down. They have bombs on them. You know, they had it all thought out ahead of time. You know, they end up saving all the children, and they come right into the center. See, I always thought that the headquarters were in the middle of this massive TIE fighter shield thing, right? I thought that was the thing that they had all this time, since the very beginning. But no, apparently the headquarters are underground beneath the Grace headquarters, or at least that's where beneath the Grace field house. That's apparently where the entrance is, at the very least. Whatever. They get down there, and then, like, all the doors open up to each of the different farms, and all of these kids come in. You know, Phil from the first season, he's playing a role in this too. Since he was, like, the only character left behind by Emma with knowledge of what's happening. And it was really cool, because I liked this scene where they had saved all these farms and all the kids were coming together, you know, and then that's where all of the mothers from each and sisters from each of the farms show up with MP5s again, because I guess that's the only gun that exists in this entire fucking world. And they all start aiming down at the children, and it's like, ooh, you know, what's going to happen here? But then, oh, here comes Mr. Peter Dinklage, and he comes walking out, and he's like, I'm evil, by the way, here's my evil face. And then Isabella walks out, but then Isabella turns her gun towards Peter, and then it's like, what the hell, there's backstabbing. And then I'm like, okay, what's gonna happen now? Are the good demons gonna show up outside the bad demon reinforcements, and then the good demons start attacking the farms, the walls? Which I don't know if that makes much sense, because I thought there was a giant pit around the walls, and I thought that there was only one bridge to get in and out of it, but whatever, I guess we'll just ignore that part. But exactly what I said was going to happen happened. And ultimately, Mr. Peter commits suicide and dies when Emma tries to save him and tries to say, we can live together, because that's the only character trait she has anymore. And then they leave. They go down the giant elevator, and all the children are sent off to the human world through the gate, except Emma and Ray and a few of, I think, in Norman's men. Or Norman's characters, I should say Norman's group, they all decide to stay behind to continue fighting in the demon world, to continue righting all the wrongs that has happened here. And this is where you'll get that slideshow where you'll see Emma and her group, her new group, I should say, that stayed behind in the demon world. You'll see a picture of the Capitol, then a picture of, like, war, and then a picture of Miss Mujica becoming a queen or something, right? You know, it's like, what the fuck? It's like they skipped over a whole season's worth of content right there, you know? And you do get to see, I will say that I appreciate getting to see the human world, because, like Aki said, she said, like, I want to see, you know, the human world at the very least before the show ends. We had 5 minutes left. 5 minutes of the final episode were left, and they hadn't shown us the human world yet. Yet characters are walking through this gate. Well, you do get to see it. You just only get to really see it in a slideshow. And the characters come out. They're greeted by people. It's a big city, maybe New York or somewhere else. I don't know exactly what city it is, but it's a very big city. It looks not unlike our current modern cities, but with some additional, like, sort of advanced looking, maybe futuristic buildings to showcase that we are in the future. But it looks like our characters were welcomed with open arms. You know, and you watch them start dressing up in what we would consider normal clothing, and they start going to school. There's, like, a school bus. I guess they're in the United States or whatever the story's equivalent is, because they've got an American school bus and all that kind of stuff there. You know, and you'll see all the characters right at the end come together when Emma comes through the gate after having been gone for so long. Like, Phil was a little baby and now he's all grown up, and then Emma comes walking through and is like, I'm back, guys. You know, so she just, whatever, I guess, fuck her whole story. We don't get to see any of that really interesting stuff. We just get to see it in a couple screenshots, basically, which really sucked. But yeah, I mean, the way that they ended it, it was really disappointing, underwhelming, yet it was still cool to see the human world. But there's still other stuff I would have wished. Like, did the humans know about the gate? After all this time, did they expect anyone to walk through? Did they, you know, did they know that these kids had come from the demon world? I don't know. Like, none of that ever gets talked about. But apparently the ending is really different. Like, there's even other screenshots. Like, you'll see one of the pictures in the slideshow, one of the frames is Emma talking to this big giant demon beast with, like, this little floating guy that's got a ball or something in his hand. And it's like, what the fuck is that? Who are they? What's the importance here? It feels like they literally just said, hey, you know what? We gotta wrap this show up, so let's put a whole bunch of frames from the manga in here and then call it a day, you know, just to say that, oh, stuff is happening, but you don't need to know what's happening, really, which sucks. But apparently the author himself, or themselves, I don't know if it's him, she, he or she, but apparently the author themselves had a hand in rewriting the ending for the anime. So apparently this is the author's doing. I don't get it. I don't know. But whoops, I hit my phone on the desk. But regardless, I mean, there's plenty of other stuff I could talk about as per usual here, like, you know, fucking bullshit. Well, actually, maybe not. Maybe I covered everything that I wanted to talk about in here. In the end, it wasn't the worst thing I'd ever seen. It's not like it was nowhere near as bad as I was as people would make you want to expect it to be. But even as a non-manga reader, yeah, they fucked it up. This show is not paced well. It's not put together, structured well at all. It is rushed. Rushed. The whole thing is rushed. Not just the ending. The whole thing is rushed. And it sucks, because what this show does introduce this season is really interesting. It's just you don't get to really care about it. You don't even get to expand upon the things that you might find interesting, which just is balls. I mean, the alternative is at least you have the manga, I guess. You know, if you want to see this story that isn't rushed, then go to the manga. But then again, I must say with one finger point, apparently the manga sucks too, okay? I don't know, I haven't read it. Apparently the manga is just like the anime in that it starts really interesting and then just fails by the end. I don't know what the context to that is. That's just what I've heard a lot of people say. So maybe the ending just sucks. Maybe that's why the author wanted to rewrite the ending for the anime, because it sucks in the books. So they were like, hey, let's try to rewrite it for the anime, but the anime's already fucking it up, so we just have to make do with what we've got. And so we still end up with a disappointing conclusion. I don't know. The conclusion itself isn't disappointing, mind you. Like, the actual conclusion of them getting to the human world isn't disappointing. It's just how it is shown is disappointing. That's the problem. But I think that's it for this discussion. I think I got most of my points across. I didn't rate this yet on Analyst, even though I already made the entries for the Maiden Abyss stuff. I didn't make the entry for The Promised Neverland Season 2 yet. But this one's nowhere near as enjoyable as Season 1, which is unfortunate, because it doesn't happen all the time, but sometimes the second season ends up not being as enjoyable as the first. And for me, this is quite a substantial drop. I did like the stuff it introduced, but I don't know where I'm going to put it. I don't know if it'll be a high-end 7 or something. It's very low for me. But it's not like a 3, you know, like a lot of people have said. It's not like that, because technically it still has a beginning, middle, and end. It's just rushed over so quickly. So with that out of the way, and that's at least one of my thoughts and opinions done, and I at least put some discussion time into it here. I got over an hour into this video. We have some more stuff to do in regards to anime. Obviously, the previous two episodes were Maiden Abyss Season 2 and the Maiden Abyss Season 2 special video, together with Papa, or whatever it's called. And coming up after The Promised Neverland Season 2 is most likely going to be a video on Mushoku Tensei Part 2, Season 1 Part 2, or Core 2, or whatever it's being referred to as. As that is something that Aki and I have already started watching after having finished this show. So if you want to see my additional thoughts and opinions on the Mushoku Tensei series, then that's where that will continue off of. And then down the road, we are probably looking at JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, A Battle in Egypt, the next part of that. And there's also the possibility that we will sit down and watch the next Mushishi thing. And then, of course, if anything else randomly pops up, then obviously we'll cover that too. But anyways, guys, thanks for watching. If you have seen Season 2 of, I almost said Maiden Abyss. If you've seen Season 2 of The Promised Neverland, feel free to post your own opinions on it down in the comment section down below. Did you like it or dislike it, and for what reasons? And you can always suggest new anime, manga, you can always suggest new anime, manga, and visual novels that I will cover in their own Thoughts and Opinions series. All suggestions get added to their respective lists, with some minor exceptions. And I will see you guys in the next anime, thoughts, and opinions video. Goodbye.